on KIRO TV and KIRO News Radio 71. Now, Brian Wood and Monica Hart, Tim Healy Sports, and John Collins Weather. From the newsroom in Seattle, this is KIRO Weekend News Update.
Good evening again. Investigators believe no one on board survived the crash of Northwest Airlines DC-9 in Detroit tonight. 147 people were on flight 255 from Detroit to Phoenix and on to California when the plane apparently caught fire and went down seconds after takeoff in Detroit. At least five people were reportedly injured when the plane struck cars on a freeway overpass. Gary Reeves has our report.
Disaster struck in Detroit tonight as a Northwest Airlines jet crashed on takeoff just before 9 this evening. The McDonnell Douglas MD-80 was headed for Phoenix when witnesses say its wing clipped a freeway overpass near the runway, then the plane slammed into the ground and burst into flames. The plane carried 141 passengers and a crew of five. Witnesses say there were some survivors, but there is no accurate count on how many.
I look over, and I seen a plane going down like this. It looked like it was taking off, but it couldn't take off. It was on fire. The whole back end was on fire. And before I knew it, like seconds like that, it just all engulfed in flames, great big flames. And it looked like it just blew up.
In the air?
Yeah, it was still in the air, from what we could see, and there was a little bit of trees, and we were still driving down 94, and we got down to where Middlebelt was right there, and it had just gone past, just like that. Everything was on fire, the trees, the grass, cars. You could see parts of everything just laying all over. It was terrible.
At least one car on the ground was reportedly struck by the plane. So far, the only confirmed survivor is a four-year-old girl. An FAA spokesman says a failure in the plane's left engine may be the cause of the crash. A team of NTSB investigators is on its way from Washington to continue the probe. Gary Reeves, CBS News, Chicago.
Again, the late word out of Detroit, it appears no one on board Flight 255 survived, and those who were injured were on the ground. The FBI has been called in because of a report, truthful or not, that there might have been an explosion prior to the crash. Now, the plane's black box recorder has been recovered from the wreckage, and as the search continues tonight for more victims and hopefully survivors, local authorities have set up a temporary morgue at the airport.
Well, tragedy near home, too. An antique biplane went down on a Bellevue golf course this afternoon. A 62-year-old Bothell man is dead, and another Bothell man is in stable condition. The plane first landed on an open fairway. Everyone was safe. But then the plane took off again and moments later crashed. A KIRO News crew saw the plane go down, as John Williams reports.
Everything appeared fine as the 1938 biplane took off from the 9th Fairway at Glendale Country Club, but then the takeoff turned to tragedy. Course raced to the crash site to rescue the two men inside. They pulled an elderly passenger from the front cockpit. He suffered critical injuries in the crash. A doctor gave him CPR right away, but later he died at Overlake Hospital. The pilot, 55-year-old Clifford Davidson of Bothell, suffered face and back injuries and is still being treated. Davidson is co-owner of Davidson Marina in the Kenmore area. Another pilot saw the takeoff and knew something was wrong.
He didn't seem to have power as he was taking off. My first thought was he wasn't going to clear the trees. And he was able to clear the trees, and he still continued to lose power.
The plane, which was returning to the Puget Sound area after an air show in Vancouver, Washington, first made a safe landing on the 9th Fairway after experiencing some engine problems.
The two men were confident just before takeoff, despite the earlier engine troubles. They refueled and were ready for the last leg home. It sounded like the plane's engine simply quit just before the crash. But this time, unlike the first landing, Cliff Davidson didn't have enough speed or altitude to get down safely. In Bellevue, John Williams, KIRO Eyewitness News.
Well, there was a near tragedy over the skies of West Germany today. An engine caught fire on an American Airlines Boeing 767 bound for Chicago. The pilot had to make an emergency landing at an airport in Frankfurt. Four people were hurt during the evacuation, but not seriously.
Though tragic, today's crashes and close calls are but a sample. Many have complained for some time, and others have warned the skies are too crowded And now the Federal Aviation Administration is reacting. In light of recent accidents, the FAA plans to restrict more airspace around SeaTac and 20 other major airports. And all planes will have to have devices which automatically tell air traffic controllers plane altitudes. Many commercial airline pilots say it's about time, but some small plane pilots object, saying the new regulations are too costly. Military police from Fort Lewis are heading to California tomorrow to pick up 32-year-old Private Ralph Myers. He's the Fort Lewis pilot who flew dangerously close to President Reagan's helicopter last week. Tonight, Myers is in a military jail in California, waiting to return to Fort Lewis, where he faces charges of being absent without leave.
Well, when we come back, the latest word on mines and minesweepers from the Persian Gulf.
And we'll have the obligatory buzz word on the Seahawks' newest player. We'll be right back.
This portion of Eyewitness News is brought to you by the Washington State Friar Commission.
Be careful. When you pass the old El Paso, you could start a party.
Pass the old El Paso. Taste the old Southwest. Pass the old El Paso. Taste our very best.
So, when you pass the old El Paso, be careful. You could really start a party.
Get to where you want to be. Use your key.
Over on the far side.
This is a great place. You know, the owner should be really proud of what he's done around here.
I am. Thanks.
Get to where you want to be. Use your key.
You think they're going to finance us?
Are you kidding? They love us.
They love us? You better let me do all the talking.
KeyBank.
Relax, partner.
Where do you want to be?
Hey. Why don't you turn on the Seahawks game?
Right.
32, ball at the Seahawks' 42-yard line. Collins with a sweep right. Looks like he may have the first down. Here's Michael Jackson on the pick. There's a fumble on the play. There's a scramble for it.
Sounds like a great game. Why don't you give me a socket wrench?
No one gets you closer to the action than KIRO News Radio 71, your Seahawks station.
Next time you turn on the radio.
There was a time when buying a German luxury car may have made sense. The value of the dollar was artificially high, the Deutschmark artificially low. But buy that same German car today, and you'll spend over 40% more just for the currency. On the other hand, buy a 1987 Cadillac Seville or Eldorado, and you'll spend every dollar on luxury and comfort. How about that?
Only one thing sets Americans apart from other nationalities, not color, not creed, not even geography, but the fact that every American citizen is a living signatory to the greatest contract ever devised among human beings for self-government, the United States Constitution. I'm Walt Crowley.
This celebration of the Constitution is brought to you by KIRO. We're working together for you.
Iran is threatening to sow mines like seeds in the Persian Gulf, but the U.S. says it can handle the situation. An American warship, the Guadalcanal, is packed from bow to stern with minesweeping helicopters, and it has slipped through the dangerous Strait of Hormuz into the Persian Gulf and is now anchored off the coast of Bahrain. Latest reports say the helicopters are already out on practice drills searching for mines. And in Kuwait, three reflagged tankers are getting ready to return through the Gulf's troubled waters. The last of the three finished taking on its oil cargo late yesterday. No word on when they'll leave port.
Iran's threat to sow mines like seeds was also aimed at Iraq. That threat came from Iran's parliamentary speaker after Iraqi warplanes bombed two oil fields in southwest Iran earlier today. And almost in the same breath, and in an unexpected turn of events, Iran says it would welcome the United Nations Secretary General to Iran. It's a surprise because Iran has repeatedly criticized the UN for failing to condemn Iraq as the aggressor in the Persian Gulf War.
And back in the States, a seven-day manhunt in Philadelphia ended today. Police arrested and charged 29-year-old Harrison Graham with murder after seven badly decomposed bodies were found in his apartment last week. Today, Graham surrendered at his mother's home after she called the police.
Well, it's good to know there are some happier, lighter things to tell you about. While many were taking it easy today, some folks were putting their minds to work outside today. Fans gathered in spiritually strategic sites around the world today, celebrating the first harmonic convergence in 23,000 years. From the pyramids of Egypt to the heights of Mount Shasta to our own Magnuson Park, they greeted the dawn, thinking and dancing for peace. 1,000 people suffered through the chill of the morning to share with each other a oneness.
It's mainly coming from our old ways of conflict and feeling that we're separate and alone into a new feeling of oneness and cooperation in the entire world.
Now, to balance all this, there are skeptics who call this convergence observance anything from antichrist to just playing old summer madness. Either way, it certainly made for an interesting day, and Tim Healy is going to join us. Now, Tim, it wasn't an interesting day for the Mariners or Mariner baseball unless you were a twin.
I was going to say, if you're a twin,
a fan.
I'm going to run that by me one more time. I know what you're saying, and you're absolutely right, and we'll explain that in a minute. Plus, we'll have a new home and a new headache for the Miami Dolphins in the NFL. Sports is next.
Why did people around the world buy over 1 billion New Zealand kiwi fruit last year? Well, maybe it's because of our good looks.
Now, it's Mazda's final 87 model clearance. Get $1,000 worth of options free from Mazda or $1,000 cash back from Mazda on all Mazda cars and trucks. On every 87 323, 626, RX-7, and truck in stock. It's your choice. $1,000 worth of options free or $1,000 cash back. Use cash back toward your down payment or get a check from Mazda. Hurry! Mazda's final 87 clearance ends soon.
Did you invite?
Well, Rose and Roger.
I'll get an extra six-pack.
The Fogles. Oh, and you can't have the Fogles without the Vogels.
Of course not.
Lance and Mark.
When soft drinks for a few friends become soft drinks for the free world.
Schuster's. Oh, the Schuster's.
The Crumbs. The
Today's 7-Eleven's got super prices without supermarket lines.
Oops, the Callahan's. The Tuckers.
Get the good things easy.
Get a six-pack of Pepsi 12-ounce cans, only $1.69.
Hiya, it's me, America's oldest romantic baritone working with America's oldest car company, Burns & Olds. Like a top billing, I'm older. Oldsmobile just reached 90. They're nice kids. I'm here to tell you about Oldsmobile's 90th anniversary celebration.
And now you can celebrate with 1.9 APR GMAC financing or up to $1,000 cash back from Oldsmobile.
We're ready to do the commercial.
I just did it.
You talk about a wasted weekend. The Mariners have spent the last 3 days fumbling a golden opportunity to gain ground in the American League West. The M's today lost their third straight to the front-running Minnesota Twins, this one by a 5-1 score. Seattle now drops 8 games out of first place. No doubt the M's play this weekend has left manager Dick Williams talking to himself in the dugout. Today's game, like last night's, was decided in the first inning. With two out, Mike Moore surrendered this double to Gary Gaetti. It scored both Steve Lombardozzi and Kent Herbeck, putting the Twins up 2-0. And then Gene Larkin ripped another double into the corner and right, scoring Herbeck. The Twins had 6 doubles in today's game. That was plenty of support for pitching ace Frank Viola, who picked up his 14th win of the season as the Twins pad their lead in the West with a 5-1 victory over the Mariners. The Paul Molitor watch continues. Today in Baltimore, Molitor lashed this opposite field double against the Orioles to extend his current hitting streak to 31 games, the longest in the major leagues this decade. In so doing, Molitor also helped his Milwaukee Brewers beat Baltimore 6-2, the count there. Oakland defeated California today 9-6. The front-running Blue Jays in the American League East beat Chicago 6-4. Ford. Detroit also won, so the Tigers are a half game back of Toronto. The Yankees lose another one, 1-0 to Cleveland, and Boston beat Texas 12-2. Well, my best friends from Arizona are up visiting this week. They are diehard Chicago Cub fans. So, Noel and Judy, this word of warning to both of you, the following videotape may be hazardous to your emotional state of health. Because today, in the friendly confines of Wrigley Field, the Cubs were wasted in not-so-friendly fashion by the New York Mets. Darryl Strawberry belting this three-run homer for the Mets. Little Lenny Dykstra muscles this one into the bleachers in dead center field. Howard Johnson later hit his 28th home run of the year as the Mets pounded out 21 hits and beat the Cubs, this is no joke, 23-10. The 23 runs, an all-time Mets record. Philadelphia dumped the Eastern Division-leading Cardinals 4-3. Montreal moved within four games of St. Louis with their 10-7 win over Pittsburgh. The Giants and Cincinnati are tied for first in the West. The Giants beat the Dodgers in 10 innings today. The Reds beat San Diego 2-0, and it was Houston 6-2 winners over Atlanta. Well, fate and the Chicago Bears combined tonight to put a damper on what should have been a festive occasion for Miami Dolphins fans. The Dolphins tonight officially moved into their new home, Joe Robbie Stadium, in suburban Miami. KIRO's Brian Wood even dropped in with the game ball for the preseason opener. But in the first half, Dolphin quarterback Dan Marino dropped out. In recovering this fumbled snap, Marino suffered a dislocated thumb. He will be sidelined about a month and might miss Miami's regular season opener in September. The only touchdown of tonight's game was produced by Bears rookie quarterback Jim Harbaugh out of Michigan, connecting on this 65-yard bomb to Ron Morris as the Bears spoiled the Dolphins' debut in Joe Robbie Stadium with a 10-3 victory. This afternoon, the Super Bowl champion Giants opened preseason play, beating New England 19-17. Superstars Greg Louganis and Carl Lewis led today's parade of U.S. medal winners at the Pan American Games in Indianapolis. Louganis won the gold medal in men's platform diving, receiving three perfect 10 scores in the process. As for Carl Lewis, he took the gold medal in the men's long jump. Then during a break in that competition, he moseyed on over to help the U.S. win the 400-meter relay. Lewis running the anchor leg in that event. An excellent day for Carl Lewis. The American men's basketball team had a good day, too, routing Uruguay. Watch Kentucky's Rex Chapman on the stufferoo here. Later, it's Chapman's in-state rival Louisville's Purvis Ellison scoring as the U.S. coasted to a 105-81 win to advance to the semifinals on Thursday. Auto racing's big winners this Sunday were Rick Mears and Bill Elliott. Mears snapping a two-year-long winless drought by capturing the Quaker State 500 IndyCar race in Long Pond, Pennsylvania, while Elliott won the NASCAR Champion Spark Plug 400 in Michigan, edging Dale Earnhardt by less than 1 second. Here's something different, a marching band on a golf course? Why not? The international tournament at Castle Rock, Colorado was different to begin with. Instead of scoring above and below par, golfers were awarded points for birdies and eagles, penalized for bogeys or worse. For John Cook, this eagle putt on the 17th green, worth 5 points, catapulted him to his first tournament victory in 4 years. Cook finished today with 11 points to win the $180,000 first prize. There are putters, then there's this contraption belonging to Orville Moody. Looks like he's got Wilt Chamberlain as a buddy. What the heck, the darn thing must work, because Orville Moody today won the Seniors Gold Rush Tournament in California. Don't forget, the seniors will be in the Puget Sound area this coming week for the GTE Northwest Classic, to be played at Englewood Country Club in Kenmore. And Brian Bosworth isn't wasting any time immersing himself in his new surroundings. The Boz today spending part of his Sunday visiting some of the young patients at Children's Hospital in Seattle. The newest Seahawk then spent most of the rest of his off day in meetings with defensive coordinator Tom Catlin in a crash course to soak up the nuances of the Hawks' defensive scheme. The Seahawks go back to work tomorrow with two-a-days out in Kirkland. And as we said yesterday, I think if there's anyone that's going to catch on fairly quickly to this scheme, it is one Brian Bosworth. Very nice of him, I thought, to head over to the hospital to visit those kitties.
True.
He has a lot to prove. He's going to start earning his $11 million now.
Of course, there's a lot of running backs in the NFL who are afraid they're going to end up in the hospital after running head-on to this guy in the field.
Okay, thanks, Tim.
And when we return, John Collins gives us a reason to smile tomorrow.
Also, one more look at the man whose music made millions of dollars and millions of fans. We're coming back. Stick around.
In recent years, automobiles have become more and more efficient, more and more advanced technologically. incorporate more features, and more alike. Which is one reason why, if you're considering buying another car, you probably shouldn't until you've seen the Sterling.
With the high price of new cars, some people are resorting to other means of transportation. But now there's the very affordable Hyundai Excel. Dependable front-wheel drive keeps you right on schedule. With room for five, there are always plenty of seats. And with all its standard features, you can still buy it for a mere token. $51.95. The Hyundai Excel. Private transportation the public can afford. Hyundai. Cars that make sense.
Somewhere in all these dusty law books, a great idea got lost. The idea that law's for people, and people should be able to afford it. At Hyatt Legal Services, we took the fear out of legal fees. You can consult with one of our lawyers for just $20. And for cases like divorce, wills, accidents, and bankruptcy, we tell you our fee up front. I'm Joel Hyatt, and you have my word on it. We took the fear out of legal fees across the country and in your neighborhood.
You've read countless news stories and seen the rioting and oppression for yourself on television. But for many people, the problems in South Africa are nothing more than headlines, nothing more than other people's problems in a land far away. On the next Oprah Winfrey Show, the story of South Africa comes to life with the story of a man who grew up in the ghettos there and survived. We'll talk about it on the next Oprah Winfrey Show.
Monday morning at 9 on KIRO-TV.
Strawberry ice cream's absolutely decadent. How's the raspberry? Killer. Hey, what kind of ice cream is this?
Surprise! It's Yoplait, new Yoplait soft frozen yogurt.
You know what? This is my most favorite ice cream in the whole world.
Surprise! It's Yoplait, new Yoplait soft frozen yogurt.
Cleanup continued today outside a tiny resort in west central Minnesota. One man died, seven others were hurt when a tornado touched down and destroyed five cabins in the resort. Meteorologist John Collins joins us. I was taking a look at your map. There's still some heavy weather there in the Midwest.
Moved a little east. We'll show you on a satellite picture in a moment what's going on this evening in the Midwest. Our weather here, a little better than yesterday. Tomorrow will be a little better than today, and I think that's where we're headed. Gradually over the next couple of days. It's just taking a long time to push this marine air out of here. Now this evening, the clouds have cleared. We have fewer clouds now than we had earlier today. It's just too bad the timing is a little off. We couldn't benefit with a little sunshine. Partly cloudy now at SeaTac. 57 the temperature, 80% the humidity. The winds have died down now. West at 3. 3024 the barometer is rising a bit, continuing to go up this evening. And a rising barometer generally means better weather. The problem is pushing the marine air out. Let's take a look at the almanac. 68 and 54 are the temperature extremes. The low was normal. The high was below normal. Now tomorrow we're going to shoot for at least closer to normal for the high. Wish us luck. Let's look at the watering. With all these clouds that we've had, the watering demand hasn't been there. But if you need to, tomorrow's watering is a square. Numbers 33 through 99, the last two digits in your address, if your lawn needs it. But if you think it can stretch out a few more days, give the reservoirs a rest. All right, let's take a look now. The satellite picture in close on the Pacific Northwest, just Washington and Oregon right now. We can see a few scattered clouds, but we've done an awfully good job of getting a lot of the low clouds and marine air, at least the cloudy part of the marine air, out of here this evening. So we'll say partly cloudy skies around the Puget Sound area this evening and most of the Pacific Northwest. Most of the clouds are off to our northwest. Here's what's going on from a satellite picture a little earlier this evening. Large area of high pressure over the Pacific, a normal situation this time of year, and a big low pool of cool air over Canada. All the weather is going between these two things at this point. We'll put the satellite in motion. By the way, this is Hurricane Jova moving around down here, slowly to the west. You see storms going over this high in a hump like this. It looks like the ridging will build in and kick these things and keep them up in British Columbia. Bad for them, good for us. At least we hope to get a little more sunshine distributed in our area. Now let's go to the Far East if you have some travel plans. Typhoon Kerry is just beginning to move into Luzon. The Luzon portion of the Philippine Islands should stay north of the Manila area if you're traveling over in that direction. 84, a summertime reading this at noontime in Tokyo. 72 at Beijing. Hong Kong, 77 at Ho Chi Minh City, formerly Saigon, 79. Wintertime down at Sydney, but warmer than they were yesterday. It's 62 with cloudy skies there. Now we'll look at the middle western portion of the United States. Hot and muggy conditions in the southeast, and the leading edge of some cool air, cold front moving along, some really powerful thunderstorms in here this evening from Wisconsin down into Illinois and even parts of Missouri. A couple of small tornadoes caused some minor damage in parts of Wisconsin. Watches for severe weather out for northern Illinois this evening. This line will continue to move tomorrow. If you have some travel plans across the United States, the southeast, warm and muggy and scattered showers and thundershowers. Ahead of that cool front, some probably pretty strong thunderstorms developing once again by tomorrow evening. In the central part of the nation, Indiana, Ohio, parts of Kentucky and Tennessee. Now, the rest of the U.S. looks pretty good. Temperature-wise, kind of warm and steamy from the East Coast all the way down in the South. Hundreds expected in central Texas. Also, the desert Southwest will be about seasonal for this time of year. The marine forecast, because of rough bar conditions, small craft advisories on the coast. Everybody else, no flags out. The strongest winds in the inland waters will be north of the Everett area. All right, here's the forecast then. Partly cloudy overnight tonight. I've reduced that from variably cloudy to partly cloudy. I'm optimistic. Mid-50s to low 50s for overnight lows. Chilliest conditions, if you could call 50s chilly, would be down in the South Sound area. Becoming mostly sunny tomorrow. There might be a few scattered morning low clouds. Mid-70s for the high at best. You may not all get up that warm, but if we get enough sun in the afternoon, that's something nice to shoot for anyway. Variable winds 5 to 15. Looking ahead, the rest of the week looks equally as good. I suspect by the middle of the week we may pick up an extra cloud or two. But most of that stuff, with any disturbances floating across, will be up in British Columbia and not down here. So temperature's about seasonal for this time of year.
Not bad. We'll take it.
Okay.
Thanks, John.
Now cross your fingers.
Yeah, that's right. Thanks.
Thanks, John. Finally, today was the day Elvis fans remembered their man. And with so much publicity, it's hard to forget that 10 years ago, this king of rock and roll died. And so in Memphis, early today, his ever-faithful fans, thousands of them, walked past the singer's grave at his home in Graceland, some holding flowers, almost all holding candles. Presley was just 42 when he died a decade ago. And that's Eyewitness News. We thank you for joining us. The Locker Room Show is next, and the CBS Sunday Night News following that.
And though it has been a rather tragic day, what with all the plane crashes and the plane fires, we wanted to leave you with music of a happier time by a man who's not been forgotten even 10 years later.
We'll see you next weekend. Have a good night.
Big one's back.
The big one from GM is back.
Mm-hmm. GM's